T5, LED, metal halide, UVA, UVB, infrared. If you're anything like me, when you go shopping for reptile lighting, you feel a little bit like a deer in the headlights. Let's see if we can't put the shades on, demystify reptile lighting a little bit, teach you the solar spectrum so you can go shopping for reptile lighting like a pro.
Dude, what are you doing now?
When you hold these up and you look at the sun, you can see all the cool different colors that come out of it.
You're looking directly at the sun?
Yeah, man, it's so I can get better light. It looks even cooler.
Dude, the sun is terribly dangerous to look at.
Nah, man, I do this all the time. It's fine. So lighting has always been one of my favorite topics to research when it comes to reptiles. There is so much to know, and a lot of it gets really sciencey, which is reptile nerds Tim and I love. We all want to provide the ideal light for reptiles, and to do that, we really need to understand the importance of the different types of light that occur in different places in the solar spectrum.
We all know that there are different colors of light, like these studio lights, or like lights that can put out nearly any color that we can see. And even lights that put out colors that we can't see. And that's a really amazing part of the sun. It puts out a huge amount of energy across all the different colors. Those different colors are described scientifically as the wavelength of light coming from the sun. But what are those wavelengths? How do we measure and test wavelengths? And what does wavelength even mean? More importantly, why do we as reptile keepers care about wavelengths in the first place?
So when we sit outside on a beautiful sunny day, or underneath really bright studio lights, because it's 25 degrees in Pennsylvania right now, not only can we see, we can feel the effects of the sun's rays. Now in nature, all light energy comes directly from the huge mass of hydrogen fusion that we call the sun. Obviously, our reptiles living outside in the wild don't have any access to fancy man-made lighting like we do. They rely on all of their light and its associated energy to come directly from the sun. Now, some of the sun's energy is dangerous, like the UV that can give us skin cancer if we stay outside too long, and some of it's great, like the infrared that makes my skin feel warm when I bask in the sun like a bearded dragon. So how do we tell the difference in different types of solar energy?
Okay, let me guess. You're measuring the wavelength of light.
Yeah, want to make sure this light's good for my reptiles.
Okay, you're doing it with a tape measure.
That is how you measure things, Tim.
Clearly, I'm going to have to show you the real way we do this stuff. As the sun burns and burns in space, it emits an enormous amount of energy. But not all of this energy reaches the Earth with this same magnitude. The way we describe how much energy the light has is in terms of its frequency. The blue line represents a high-frequency waveform. You can see it goes up and down a lot. Whereas a low frequency within the same unit of distance goes up and down less. In addition to the frequency, we need to know the wavelength. The wavelength is easy to measure. It's simply the distance from peak to peak of one complete waveform. You'll see that higher frequency, higher energy light has a shorter wavelength and vice versa for low energy. The unit of measure for a wavelength is a nanometer. And one nanometer is equal to 0.00000003937 inches. I don't think Jack was going to be able to measure that with a tape measure.
So we know that when we see different colors of light, or we feel warmth in our skin from the sun, it's actually a whole bunch of different wavelengths of energy that we're seeing and feeling. We also know, as reptile keepers, that our animals need all sorts of light, whether it's UV, visible, or infrared. Just mentioning these brings up our next important topic. How do we classify different wavelengths of light?
As we described earlier, the sun emits enormous amounts of energy, but not all of this energy reaches the Earth's surface. That's because of the effect of the atmosphere. A lot of the energy is either absorbed or deflected by the atmosphere. What does make its way to Earth is considered the terrestrial spectrum. And this range is from 290 nanometers all the way up to about 2,500 nanometers. This lowest section has the highest frequency and therefore shortest wavelength of all, and we refer to it as UV. It's only 8% of the total amount of light, though. Above this, we get into the visible spectrum. This is what we see. This is Roy G. Biv. Within the visible spectrum, which accounts for about 43%, is what plants need. That section is called PAR, photosynthetically available radiation, and we'll get into more details about that later. Above 700 nanometers, we're well into the infrared portion, and believe it or not, that's actually half of all the light that's emitted from the sun that actually reaches the Earth. What's amazing is that all the animals that we keep and all the animals on the Earth in general have evolved to use various portions of this spectrum. But the sections of the spectrum that matter most depend on their niche, and that's important.
So let's talk about an easier way to understand wavelength than a whiteboard with a bunch of spectrogram drawings on it. Behind me here is one example of visible and infrared light, and it's a fireplace in a home, or in this case, it's our really cool 1950s fireplace. What we see coming off of it is both the visible light, the beautiful reds, oranges, and colors, and we can feel, when we put our hand up to it, the infrared light that makes our skin warm. But what about the other portion of the solar spectrum, UV? So when we go tanning in a tanning bed, or we go and lay out in the sun to get our suntan, what we can see is the results of the UV energy, both in the sun or in the tanning bulb lamps, and we see that through the tan that we receive from that UV energy. Now, it's important to say too much of the wrong UV at the wrong wavelengths is responsible for all sorts of negative effects like skin cancer, cataracts, and sunburn. And that's not just for us, it's also for our reptiles. That's something we'll absolutely explore a lot more of in a future video on UV lighting for our reptiles.
There are many different measurements of light that can be done, but the most common one for evaluating lights, especially for use with our reptiles, is with this tool called a spectrometer. Put simply, it measures the light coming into this sensor and shows exactly what wavelength and how much of each wavelength is present. While a spectrometer is the most scientific way to measure a light or the sun's output, they're very expensive, so it's not really worth it to buy one for the average reptile keeper. But this is too bad, because then it becomes the job of the light's manufacturer or people in the community to provide spectrogram data for review to determine whether a light is good for your reptile. So let's learn how to read the output of a spectrometer, which is called a spectrograph, so that you can make informed decisions when you go to buy your next reptile light.
Now this is a spectrograph. Even more specifically, it's a spectrograph of the sun's light as it hits the surface of the Earth. If we remember from earlier, the sun at the Earth's surface has from around 290 nanometers to well beyond 700 nanometers. You can start to see in the spectrograph the breakdown in different types of solar energy, and importantly, how much of it actually reaches us through the atmosphere. Not only can we see how much energy the sensor receives, we can see the exact wavelength of that energy. This allows us to determine just how much of each wavelength exists in any light that we test. But why is that important in the first place?
From our Europlatus fantascus that have evolved to look perfectly like a leaf, to our chameleons that have feet that are ideal for climbing and living their lives in the trees. The natural world has solved so many problems of life over time and comes up with many different solutions that are unique to each species.
One of the constants in the natural world, for as long as reptiles and all life on Earth has been here, is the sun's daily rise and set, and the wavelength of light that comes with that on a daily basis. What's really cool about reptiles is that all of them have adapted to the sun and its energy in very different ways. Now, when we look at many of our favorite geckos, like this Europlatus fantasticus behind me, we know that they're primarily nocturnal, and they avoid the harshest of the sun's daily rays, and they come out at night to be active. But they do still rely on the lighting, and if you look at this guy right here, you can see he's actually sleeping right underneath the sun. They do still need that light to help regulate them on a daily basis. So certain animals like desert species or iguanas like our friend Noodle here, they love a lot of sun on a daily basis and even come out to bask like she's doing right now. So how is it that we can provide the absolute best lighting products for our beautiful animals? Well, by understanding the sun spectrum by itself, understanding how to read spectrographs like we showed you earlier, and by making sure that we use both of those bits of knowledge to pick the absolute best products for the animals that we love and care for.
In keeping our reptile pets in terrariums, we don't have the luxury of providing natural sunlight in the exact right amounts as found in the wild. What we can do, though, is look to the spectrum of a light, examine how much of each wavelength is output, and match a given light to our animals.
In our videos on UV lighting needs and understanding the PAR with LED lighting, We'll show you a bit more about how to choose the right lights to put over your terrariums. But now that you have some understanding of the spectrum of natural sunlight and how to evaluate a spectrograph of lights you may want to buy, you'll absolutely be able to make a happier and healthier habitat filled with the exact right amount of light.